Come on and give God some Holy Ghost praise this morning. We bless the Lord because he's high above the earth. Come on, give him glory. Yeah.
Oh, come on and give God praise, y'all. Give him the highest praise, for he is worthy. All right.
Good morning and welcome to Asbury Town Neck United Methodist Church, where Reverend James A. Bishop is the senior of the house, and Minister Carla Fleming's your host today. And whether you're a member or a friend or tuning in to our time together for the first time, we just are thanking you for just worshiping with us again on what we call the Asbury Town Neck or ATN Network. Well, this morning, before I get started, I've been asked to share an announcement. It's called an appointment announcement with you this morning. And this is on behalf of the president and chairperson of our staff pastor parish committee, SPRC, Mrs. Brenda Watkins. And it reads as thus. It is my joy to share with you today that Bishop Latrell Easterling has appointed Reverend Dr. Tori Butler as the new pastor of our congregation. Dr. Butler will begin her new responsibilities on July 1st of this year. And as a United Methodist Church, we're a part of an appointment system. Our congregation staff parish relations committee has met with the district superintendent to identify our congregation's needs and the needed skills of a pastor. We have also met with Dr. Butler to get to know her better and to ask questions. And that concludes the announcement for the appointment announcement. And that being said, this means that Reverend James Bishop, who has been with us almost 10 years, is retiring this year after 46 years of faithful ministry to start a new chapter yet to be written. Amen? Amen. Well, this past week, our Bible study concluded its third week of an Epiphany study. We concluded with a study on Jesus' first miracle, which was to turn water into wine. And one of the lessons we learned was that he saved the best for last. But I wanted to highlight an important part that is often overlooked. When Jesus' mom said to him, you know, they've ran out of wine, Jesus told his servants to fill the water pots. And then the Bible tells us that the servants filled the pots to the brim. God uses what we have in our hands. And in this case, it was the water pots. And secondly, the servants' posture was one of expectancy. They filled it to the brim, it said. They didn't half step. Sometimes we half step. We do just enough to say that we did something. May I offer this challenge to you today? If you're going to believe up to the brim. If you're going to love up to the brim. If you're going to serve up to the brim. And if you're going to give up to the brim. Somebody say amen. Amen. Remember, God is faithful with his promises to us. Anything that he has promised, he will deliver. And may we hear the joyful sounds that the best has been saved for the last. Well, today's scripture is coming from the book of Psalms, Psalms 91, verses 1 through 11. And it's going to come out of the Message Bible this morning. And today's sermon title is Spending a Night in Shaddai's Shadow. Spending the night in Shaddai's shadow. Will you pray with me this morning? Heavenly Father, like every Sunday, may we be reminded, God, that it's all about you. Please help us to worship you with an undistracted heart. We thank you, Lord, that even though we're not out of the woods yet, we're starting to see the light, some hope, and some breakthroughs, especially as it relates to the vaccines, the available vaccines. God, we ask that you touch our sick and our shut-in, God, and especially those who have in some shape or form been affected in the wake of this virus. Father, we ask that you bless those who give today. Give them a special blessing, God, for their faithfulness and for their commitment to you. May they give up to the brim in the advancement of your church and for your kingdom. That their latter, God, be better, come on, than their former. Now, God, calm our minds, calm our fears, and remove anything, God, that would stand in the way of us getting what you have for us to feast on today. Open our eyes, God, that we can see you, our ears that we can hear you when you speak, and ready our heart to receive that which you have for us to feast on, God, today. Bless our pastor as he imparts and he declares your word. Bless the choir, God, and the musicians and all those who have had a hand in the proclamation and the declaration of your word. And God, May our worship, God, bring you glory and bring you praise. It's in Jesus' name, God, that we pray. Amen.
Come on, give God some more glory.
Amen.
132 years of worship. God is worthy of all the praise. You know, when I think about the next song that we're about to minister, I think about how my grandmother used to say, if you don't praise him for yourself, the rocks are going to cry out. And I don't want no rocks crying out for me. I want to praise him for myself. I want to let them know that I love you. I want to let them know that I'm depending on you. I got to let God know that I'm leaning on you for your grace and your mercy, because I need you every hour. Somebody ought to give God some praise. So as my grandmother used to say, and as the word says, if you don't praise him for yourself, the rocks are going to cry. If the rocks can give God glory, why can't we?
Yeah. That's right.
So we're going to praise God just because he's God all by himself.
Thank you, Jesus.
I'm sorry, y'all. I just had to get that off.
Thank you, Jesus.
Hallelujah. If I don't.
Rocks crying out.
Come on, can we go?
Don't want no rocks
crying out for me.
Rocks crying out in
come on,
my
take a
hand.
Say if I don't. Praise the Lord.
Praise the Lord.
They said the rocks are gonna cry out.
Rocks are going to cry out.
I don't want no rocks.
I don't want
praising him for me.
No one, no rocks.
Crying out in my place. Because he's been so good to me. Through all the trials, he's been so good to me. I don't know how I'm still standing today. I've had more tragedy in the past few months than some people have had in their whole lives. But I'm holding on. I'm holding on. My mother used to say, I'm holding on to God's unchanging hand. He'll make a way for me.
Yes, he will. Yes, he will.
Thank you, Lord.
Thank you, Lord.
Hallelujah.
Thank you, Lord.
Come on, can we say it one more time? If I don't, if I don't.
If I don't.
Yes, God.
Praise the Lord. The rocks are going to cry out. Don't want no rocks. Rocks crying out in my place.
Come on and bless the Lord. Hallelujah. Give him glory because he's so worthy of the praise. Hallelujah. Thank you, God.
Will you read with me the word that's coming out of the Message Bible, Psalms 91, 1 through 11. You who sit down in the high God's presence, spend the night in Shaddai's shadow. Say this, God, you're my refuge. I trust in you and I'm safe. That's right. He rescues you from hidden traps, shields you from deadly hazards. His huge outstretched arms protect you, and under them, you're perfectly safe. His arms fend off all harm. Fear nothing, not wild wolves in the night, not flying arrows in the day, not disease that prowls through the darkness, not disaster that erupts at high noon. Even though others succumb all around you, drop like flies right and left, no harm, and even graze you. You'll stand untouched, watch it all from a distance, watch the wicked turn into corpses. Yes, because God's your refuge, the high God, your very own home. Evil can't get close to you. Harm can't get through the door. He ordered his angels to guard you wherever you go. And if you stumble, they'll catch you. Their job is to keep you from falling. This is the word of God for the people of God. And the church says, thanks be to God. Well, El Shaddai, I just want to just lift up just a couple of highlights, and Reverend Bishop will bring that plane on down. But El Shaddai means the God of heaven. You know, the Message of Bible gives us a clear picture of not only some advantages, but some assurance of God's protection. Verses 1 and 2 focuses on the protection, the comfort, and the care of El Shaddai. Verses 3 and 4 says how God brings his protection, his comfort, and his care, and that he rescues us, he shields us, and he outstretches his arms. But this is only if you're positioned under the shadow of El Shaddai. The New King James Version speaks of the fowler and how it works. It says that the fowler works in secret. He changes up his traps and his methods, and he entices us. But if you sit under his shadow, he is giving us all this protection, comfort, and care. Verses 5 and 6 are the results of God's protection and care. See, we don't have to be afraid when these things come, because we take refuge, come on, in his arms. So having God as a shelter and refuge gives us strength and courage. And this is the assurance to God's people that rest in his shadow. Verses 7 and 8 gives us the assurance of the believers, because the psalmist describes how God's protection conquers any odds and probabilities. God's protection and care could be specifically focused that it can be used to preserve us as we're going through. And verses 9 and 11 often repeat the whole promise of his deliverance and his assurance of victory. Deliverance and assurance of his victory, because we're making him our dwelling place. And then it says that he will give angels guard over us. And I like how it says, he says he'll order the angel to guard you wherever you go. That if you stumble, come on, he's going to catch you. And that is our assurance. So I don't want to give away the rest of the story. Reverend Bishop will land this plane down. But as you think of Psalms 91, 1 through 11, think about the protection. Think about the assurance and the advantages of resting under the arms of El Shaddai. Amen? Amen.
Somebody say, forever's a long time. That's how long God is going to love you. I'll be committed to you. I'll never leave you. Nothing in this world could make me walk away. No matter what life may bring, I'll be by your side. No matter what you face, you won't be lonely. Forever is a long time. That's how long. matter what you're going through. God's love in motion. Here's a message from the ATN Network.
Greetings, church family, and to all of our viewers. Welcome to the ATN Network. Because of your continued generosity, we have remained fully operational during these troubled times. We've also expanded our ministry, broadcasting our 9 a.m. worship service via live stream, which has reached many people abroad. In conjunction with ACAN, we have been able to provide many essential food items for survival during this COVID-19 pandemic. Currently, we have four ways to give. You can call 410-647-3461 to arrange a drop-off in person. You can mail it to 429 Asbury Drive, Savannah Park, Maryland, 21146. You can visit our website at www.asburytownnet.org and then click online giving. Or you can text to give at 877-202-0448. Malachi 3:10 reads, "Bring the whole tithe into the storehouse, that there may be food in my house. Test me in this, says the Lord Almighty, and see if I will not throw open the floodgates of heaven and pour out so much blessing that there will not be room enough to store it." Once again, thank you for your continued support, and God bless.
Good morning. I am again delighted to be with you and to worship today together, as we have been for 10 months, ready to move into the 11th month. Let me say a word about the announcement that was made, and I am so happy for this church, because my retirement is mandatory. So it has been known by the bishop and the district superintendent for some time. And that being the case, they knew that I was retiring, so I think they were thinking then about who might come and continue the work of ministry in this church. And for that announcement to come in the first month of the appointment-making process, to me, 46 years in the ministry, is a very, very good sign. So I'm happy for you. I did some research lately about how societies work. And I was particularly interested in the large societies, the ones that have been powerful in history, the Roman Empire, Egyptians. And I discovered something in looking at many of them that was not so much a surprise to me, but maybe to you. What I discovered is this: most great societies that end up in a downfall or most great societies that are weakened significantly so that even if they bounce back, they bounce back only to a certain degree. What I discovered was that all of those societies that have had the problems that caused them to be destroyed or almost destroyed, every one of them, almost every one of them, the experience was the result of internal conflict and turmoil. You watch enough Hollywood, and it may be easy to come to the conclusion that back in those days, other nations would come and invade and destroy a society. But that's not true. They are usually destroyed or weakened as a result of internal conflict and turmoil, not external factors. And that's important to understand when we look at this nation of ours. Because if we don't examine those things and take a real good look at them, we may end up in some serious trouble without even knowing it. I've been reading some materials also about the COVID-19 situation, this incredible pandemic, the biggest one the world has seen for a little over 100 years. And I'm amazed that most preachers will use the 91st Psalm to preach to their congregations to bring them comfort regarding this COVID-19 pandemic. And that's fine. I have no criticism for that, because it gives the assurance to people that everything's going to be all right. My concern is that the greatest threat on our nation right now really is not COVID-19 pandemic. The greatest threat to our nation is internal conflict and turmoil. And if you don't check it, it will come like Satan comes, Jesus says, like a thief in the middle of the night. And it will come and it will destroy and devour. And before you know it, you will be gone. So what I did was to look at some things that I think have been significantly important in our culture, our society, as well as some of the societies that I have mentioned that were destroyed or weakened. And believe it or not, I came up with 24 things that I call, it's my list that I call the until it's not test. In other words, something's good until it's not. And if you want a copy of this, I may move too fast for you to write all of these down. Just give us a call and we'll give you a copy. And I'd love to give you a copy so that you can add to my list. And by the way, these are very objective terms that I want to share with you. And so I had to pull my cell phone out. I do have a good memory, and I organize things so that I can remember to preach, but I can't remember these 24, nor did I even try to. So here, listen to me, because I'm going to move kind of fast with it. Things that are good until they are not. And we'll see objectively what the real issue at hand is in our nation. Justice is good until it's not. The rule of law is good until it's not. Law and order are good until they are not. Democracy is good until it's not. Truth and facts, that's two different ones. Truth is good until it's not. Facts are good until they're not. Honor is good until it's not. Patience is a virtue until it's not. Protect the children and value God's children is the principle until it's not. Family values is important until it's not. Civil rights is important until it's not. Civility is important until it's not. Voting rights, important until they are not. Liberty is important until it's not. Unity is important until it's not. Peace and harmony is important until they're not. Patriotism is important until it's not. Insurrection is bad until it's not. Character is valued until it's not. Equal rights is important until it's not. Human rights is important until it's not. Hospitality is important until it's not. Respect for others is important until it's not. Tolerance is important until it's not. It's 24 things that I came up with. And let me share with you the process by which that happened. And so when I started the list, I had about 9 things. And every time I turned around, I thought about something else. And I would just continue to add things to my list. And when all good things are good, as those things that I just named, when all good things are good until they're not, then we're in trouble. Now, I hear some preachers who will preach a sermon of doom. I don't wish to do that, so stay with me just for a few more minutes, because I do want to use Psalm 91 to lift you up. So the question that you may be pondering is then, if things are so bad and people are ignoring the good, but we are people of God and we are not ignoring those things. And Pastor, we still believe in all of those 24 things that you said. Why would we have to suffer with everybody else? Good question. Well, Psalm 91 answers that question. And we don't have to suffer. Even while we're in the midst of things going downhill, we don't have to suffer. And Psalm 21 tells us why we don't have to suffer. Collard did an exegesis of this text, did it very well, and explains that if we are in God, if we trust in God, if we learn to rely on God, if we just keep building a strong relationship with God, then we will be protected from all of the evil and harm that is happening right around us. And I'm not talking so much about physical protection, even though I believe that too. I'm mostly concerned about the protection of the soul. You remember when I have preached and I have carefully defined the difference between body, soul, and spirit. And the soul is our life. And so that life that we have in Christ is protected from all of this stuff that's going wrong and going bad in our nation. So the first thing, I want to do 3 things at least. I have to take all of that beautiful scripture and compact it. The first thing I want you to know is that if we hide ourselves in the shadow, that is incredible. In the shadow of the Almighty, El Shaddai. In the shadow, can you imagine that? I saw some sketches of people doing that, and there's this great big wing, and somebody is gathered under that wing, like chicks are gathered under the wings of a hen, mother hen, for protection. But when scripture's not even saying that, it's saying under the shadow to spend one day. You remember those TV commercials? They've gone away. I love those commercials about how Holiday Inn Express. I just loved them so much because in those commercials, they had different experiences that people had. But regardless of the experience, if you spend one night in the Holiday Inn Express, it'll make you a different person. I read about it and I'm troubled about the fact that there are children who are committing suicide, and there are many other people who are so stressed out because of the things that are going on in this world now, they can't find any other way out except to take their own life. And I have news for people who get stressed out, and even those of us Christians who believe in the list that I read, we get stressed out. Oh yeah. But when you get stressed out, the commercial would say, then you need to spend the night in the Holiday Inn Express. And when you wake up in the morning, you'll be a different person. If you spend one night in that Holiday Inn, if you spend your life, and it's not hard to do, if you spend your life in the Word of God, whenever trouble comes, this has been my experience, whenever trouble comes, God has a way of bringing to mind those things that you've been studying. And all of a sudden, when you feel all stressed out, you find yourself feeling better. In spite of all, nothing much has troubled me more than some of the violence that happened in our nation. Sandy Hook, 22 children killed. The children killed in the high school in Florida. Those things bother me so much, but not to the point that I want to do something foolish. God brings to mind what I need to hear, and in my case, so that I can at least preach to you and find some comfort for myself, and let God continue to use me. Carla says, fill up those jugs to the brim. And if your cup is running over, then you won't find that you are in such a bad situation as you could otherwise conclude. And the second thing, the psalmist says, and let me tell you about this because this is really important. We don't know who wrote the 91st Psalm. So we can identify some psalms that David wrote, Solomon and others, but we don't know who wrote this psalm, which makes it really significant since it is included in the Psalms. It's very important because it means somebody just like you and me who had this experience with God, somebody just like you and me. David was a great man. Solomon was a great man. Joshua was a great man. And anybody like that who would have written scripture, then we say that's good because these were great people. But we don't know who this writer was, because he was somebody just like you and me who had experienced the goodness of God. And so the second thing I want to say about this scripture is not only will God protect us, but when there is danger, and I'm still talking about the soul, when there is danger and when there is this feeling that I just can't take it anymore, God will send angels to protect us. You know what I find to be so interesting in the world we live in today, because, and I'm so glad that so many people are educated, but one of the problems with intellectualism is that if you are too intellect, if you use too much of the intellect, sometimes you'll drown out the obvious things that happen. And so a lot of people that I know, Christians, just don't believe in angels. I had a colleague once who had an experience, and he was in the church parsonage, and there had been a storm, and there had been some flooding, and there was flooding in his basement. And he was going down into the basement, walking through the water, and he was getting ready to unplug something down in the basement. And just before he unplugged it, standing in that water, a gas man just happened to knock at his door. He had not called the gas man. The gas man was in the neighborhood for somebody else, but he just happened to go over to this house, and he knocked on the door and interrupted him from touching that live wire. And he told him, he said, "I just stopped to let you know what was going on, and so be careful not to touch anything while you're wet." And then my colleague in ministry told me, he thought that was a great story to tell, but he ended the story by saying, he said, it was almost like an angel came, not like, almost. Because we have experiences where God will send angels. I don't have time to name the experiences that I've had where God has sent, and not always because I'm getting ready to light myself up, but sometimes in other constructive ways, helpful ways, God is sending angels in the body of somebody else. I remember one occasion when a man did something to help me so much. I don't have time to tell that story. And I remember later on thanking him for saying what he had said, because I found it to be very helpful, and he did not remember saying it. Angels would come and care for us and take care of us. Angels are coming. You just have to experience them, and you have to believe it. And if you believe it, then when something happens in your life, you'll say, "God sent an angel." Through somebody else, one of my brothers and sisters in Christ. And then the final thing I want to say is that after all of this happens, and you've had a good night's rest in the care of El Shaddai, and after you have been protected by angels, then God is going to set it up so that right in front of the evil one, God's going to provide a party for you, and you can have a good time singing and praising God for what God has done in spite of all of the things that are going on around. It's going for a party. I remember when I was a boy and I used to hear in communion and other settings, and I would hear preachers say, my daddy would say, he said, "He spreads his banner over us." Oh, it's like a party you've never seen, like you never experienced. And at that party, we're going to all be surrounded by a great cloud of witnesses who are looking down on us and celebrating because they've made it over. And they are there to help us to believe and to understand that we're going to make it. We're going to make it. Now let me back up, because I don't want this misunderstood. I think COVID is a problem, but I think that COVID is not an internal problem. It's only that we are experiencing it within the nation. it comes from an external force. And I don't have any reason to believe that it won't be long. It's coming soon. And COVID is going to be a thing of the past. But likewise, the internal problems that exist. And you know, the scripture tells us it's not that hard. Love the Lord your God with all your heart and your soul and your mind and your strength. And love your neighbor as you love yourself. And everything's going to be all right. Pray with me. God, we just seek your blessings. We ask you, God, to help us to be closer to you. So when storm winds blow, we won't panic. Help us to understand, God, that if we're in the midst of the storm, we have faith in Jesus Christ. If we turn to the right or to the left or look in front of us or look behind us, we'll see that Jesus is right there. And he's always been there. And all we have to do is turn to him. So I ask you, God, to bless our nation and give us peace. And thank you, El Shaddai, God of heaven, for coming down to us in Jesus Christ. We give you all the praise and all the honor and all the glory that already belongs to you. In your son's name we pray. Amen.
Some more praise. Come on, praise the Lord. Hallelujah. Taking place today. As we leave the sanctuary,
as we leave the sanctuary,
as we go our separate,
as we go our separate ways,
may God's favor rest upon thee.
Rest upon thee.
May he cover you with
may
his grace.
Cover you.
Y'all can help us sing it this time. As we leave this sanctuary.
As we leave this sanctuary.
As we go our
separate
ways.
As we go our separate ways.
May God's favor rest
may
upon
God's thee. Favor rest upon thee.
May he cover you
may
with his
grace.
Together again. Let's take it higher. bless the Lord. Amen. Good. Hallelujah. Give them glory.
We fall down, but we get up. We fall down, but we get up. We fall down, but we get up. Oh, yes. For a saint is just a sinner.